result with better learning outcomes. Additionally, research suggests that parents should move away from limiting screen time and instead start creating a dialogue between their children so that they can have better habits around using media. Additionally, we conducted a competitive analysis. So we looked at both direct and indirect competitors, such as Netflix, Amazon Free Time, YouTube Kids, and Nintendo Switch. And we found out that the first part was that we wanted to plan out parental controls up ahead, not as an afterthought. And we saw this when we were looking at Netflix very closely. We saw that Netflix had fragmented their parental controls kind of across the system, and it felt like it was an afterthought that they had once they'd already launched. The other thing was that we wanted to empower curation of a child's experience by additionally giving activity monitoring to parents in order to surface a child's interests. Again, going back to trying to create that open dialogue between a parent and a child. And lastly, we found that flexible control styles for parental administration was very important and was seen across two of the platforms that we looked into. Lastly, with all this research, we realized we need to prioritize what type of features we wanted to build in the parent experience. So we ran a parent survey to try to understand what features were helpful at home and at the hospital. And we saw that there was an overlap between at home and in the hospital features around parents wanting to be co-present when kids are engaging in the media, activity monitoring, and content blocking. So just to recap, we completed the discover and define phases at this point, and by doing a competitive analysis, usability testing, user interviews, as well as user surveys. And they really helped us understand what we wanted to move forward with for the design phase, which Maria will talk about now.
So now we're finally ready to start designing. All of this research boiled down to three different goals. We wanted to help SOT introduce itself. Remember, this was the burden that the caregivers had. We wanted to help take that off of them through our design. We also wanted to help the parents understand and learn from the activity that their children were servicing on the app. We also wanted to provide customization tools for parents. Keeping these goals in mind, we created a new parent user flow. So remember, the parent experience didn't exist on the app yet. We created this. Then we sketched out our ideas for design and copy, and we developed interactive wireframes that we tested with 5 users. From those 5 users, we learned that it made more sense to have a parent and child sign up together, and we also learned where we need to provide more context to our users to help them throughout the flow. This user feedback propelled us into the next stage of high fidelity design, which included the following features. The onboarding experience. This experience was to help Zot introduce itself within the platform and present the benefit of the platform, not just the features, right off the bat, and appeal to parents and get that parental buy-in that we knew would help increase Zot's engagement. Out of respect for the client, we developed a white label prototype, and it included a 4-panel dialogue as part of the sign-in process to quickly communicate to the parents what they were getting into before they signed in. We also created a parent dashboard. This dashboard was very simple. It has metrics about usage that parents could use, not to set limits, because that didn't matter in the hospital setting. They're just trying to distract and entertain children. But we wanted to give them control so that they could see not just how long a child has been using the platform, but where their interests have been taking them. How have they been using the platform, and what content are they consuming, so that they could have more of that joint media engagement together and talk about what's going on the platform. A parent can log in to their password-protected account, manage any associated child profiles. In this case, you could see you could add a profile for a multi-user household. And they can also see on this dashboard different types of content, including the category breakdown. So you could see if a child is watching a lot of videos about tigers, that maybe this is something you could talk about. Maybe this is something you could capitalize on in other ways and create a better engagement. We also provided parents extensive controls over the type of content that they could let their child use. We talked about how the importance of appropriate content, how important that is to have that access to this. So we created two different ways, flagging and blocking, preemptive and reactionary content controls. This is an example of how we designed the flagging process. So in context, a user could right away flag and report content that they found offensive. Zot and the platform itself already restricts content based on the child profile's age, and then the hospital itself adds additional layer of content creation. And this was one way we thought that parents could have their voice in the process and customize this. We also presented in our dashboard a blocking feature. So parents could get granular controls on the exact type of content they wanted to block. So if your child is terrified of ghosts, you could go in here and try to restrict your child from seeing things that are particular to your family's needs or promote your family's values, however you feel about that. So we took this high-fidelity interactive prototype and we tested it with 6 users from user testing. These were some of the key insights that arose. The first one that really stood out to us and that we were pleased by and surprised by, but not really surprised by, was that, will this cost me? Parents were so sensitive to any cost that's accrued in the hospital. So if you think of a hospital like a hotel, you go in and you're thirsty and you see a water bottle, but you're afraid to drink the water at the hotel because it might show up as a $16 water bottle on your bill, you know, 6 days later. And hospitals are the same way. There's not price tags on things. So you're not sure, there's no transparency about price. And so parents were concerned, if I sign up for Zot, is this gonna show up on my bill later? And this makes sense. We appreciated this insight into their emotional journey, and we added content about cost at the very first panel of our introduction to address this concern right off the bat in the first touch. We also created, as part of our solution for the introduction problem, we created hard copy printed materials that could be given to a family when they sign into a hospital or get admitted to a hospital, or it could be awaiting them in the hospital room that could do some of that introduction for them, and we also address the cost issues in that marketing material. We found that some users struggle to locate and identify exactly how to flag content, and so what we did is on our interface, we made our icon bigger and we added a label to make it more clear to our users. And we had a really interesting, one user had a very enlightening comment about adjusting our wording. We use the word blocking, which has very negative connotations. But one user suggested that reframing this feature as an empowering customization would be more accurate. And we really liked this idea because it embodied more of the Zot experience, this peace of mind in a stressful situation. And we thought that that idea about customization was more appropriate. So we incorporated it, removed the word blocking, and added the word customization. So these were some of the results that came out of our user testing. They also had a lot of very positive things to say about the prototype. One user said that they didn't struggle locating anything. Another called it goof-proof, which is a phrase I really like now. And another user, even though it was their very first time seeing the interface, felt like they were a returning user, which I don't know if you can get a better compliment than that. We also asked our users to take a 10-question survey known as the System Usability Score. This is an industry standard metric that can help that industries use as a benchmark to judge the usability of their designs against industry-wide systems. 80 is considered a good score, and our users gave us a 94, so meaning there were no major usability issues. As for our clients, they were also very pleased. Our research and final designs proved to be very valuable to our partner, who indicated that they found the results of our work to be very helpful and intend to implement this in future developments. The key insight about cost transparency was particularly helpful to Zot, and our partner wondered how long it would have taken them to get to that insight in the wild, since right now they're primarily interfacing with staff members, and it's because of the nature of the product, it's a little harder to get in touch with the parents themselves. So at the end of our 6 months together, we had transformed the parent experience from being non-existent and over the shoulder into an integral and fully featured part of the platform. Thank you.
Any questions? Chatting, sorry.
Yeah.
I saw that you mentioned things like YouTube and YouTube streaming and Twitch. Did you consider other kind of streaming things like video chat with parents or any kind of chat protocol for that?
Yeah. So they decided to use Zot. Zot has Twitch and YouTube there, but it's not like integrated anyway. Right now, it's just kind of iframe into there.
Yeah, it's on our product roadmap for a few months down the road. So we're kind of in a pilot program right now. We have our MVP product, but that's probably going to be a 2019 thing because we certainly see value in that as well.
And if you do want to integrate that kind of thing, Graham works at Twitch. So
I'm that's awesome. Well, actually, our CTO was the one of the original founders of Twitch. So, yeah, you may know him.
There you go. All righty, thank you, guys. We are running ever so slightly behind schedule, so instead of giving you a full 15-minute break, I'm going to give you the stand-up and because it is personally and deeply meaningful to me. So hopefully you will all feel this way as well, and if you don't know what I'm talking about, it will become very clear very soon. So with that, we'll let Melissa get started.
That's a great intro. Hi, everybody. I'm going to have to talk loud. I have taught many of you in this room. I'm going to teach many more of you in this room. You get a lot of me in this program, but even though I bring it up every once in a while, very rarely do I talk about my own research. I think many of you have a sense of who I am and what I'm interested in, but Jillian said this was an opportunity where I could just talk about my own research. Kind of change the conversation a little bit. At this point, I hope that those of you who just presented are feeling pretty awesome. That those of you who are about to start the program are feeling pretty invigorated. Maybe a little nervous, that's okay. But now we're going to change the conversation, and we're just going to talk about our lives. So I'm taking us a very different direction than what Allie started us off with today. But I'm going to think about what is the state of, what is it like to be a professional in today's day and age in some sort of Western context, which basically means everybody in this room. And many more besides us. So what we're going to talk about today is technology and the ideal worker in the age of impossible ideals. And what I mean by that is we're going to talk a little bit about who are our heroes. What do you guys think of when you see this picture? Neil Armstrong. This is the entrepreneur, potentially. Potentially, this is the rugged individual. Potentially, this is the lone genius. All of these figures are heroes in Western culture. And we believe that they have and will continue to change what it is, what we build, what we create, what we explore, and what we do. We're going to talk a little bit about jokes. I don't know if you can read this in the back. This is a very subtle joke that says, all work and no play makes you a valued employee. Very subtle. The best part about it is the fact that the guy here at the desk looks somewhat surprised by this. That's the part I find funny. This is a joke, but it's also very much characterized as a lot of how we experience our lives, or at least how we tell ourselves we should be experiencing our lives, that this is what valued employees are. We're going to talk a little bit about archetypes and how, in some ways, heroes plus jokes plus all the subtle ways that we perpetuate our culture of what we value, what we reward each other for, when we go to sleep at night, what we feel good about, how all these things come together in the everyday lives of working professionals. So who is this archetype? Who is this person?
Multitasking.
First of all, he's a guy. He's also Caucasian. He's also very attractive. In that very particular kind of way. He's also a multitasker. Is he a professional? Is he getting things done? So maybe. Is he a valued employee? Maybe. Is he good at his job? Maybe. Does he have a life outside of work?
No.
So there's a very classic myth that actually a lot of academics are quite interested in exploring and articulating and understanding the consequences of, which is the myth of the ideal worker, which very much populates what it is to be a professional in today's day and age. And this person, although it is a masculinely gendered myth, it's not always men, obviously, this person is someone who, without even thinking about it, will happily work from home. They will consider that a privilege much of the time. They will happily maintain accessibility and be at the ready for an email or a text or a, do you mind printing off this report for me at midnight? They will happily, I'm not so happy on this one, they are willing to exhibit FaceTime. They're willing to show up, whether it's at the client site, whether it's getting on, a plane the last minute to go to that special meeting, and in the office every day. exhibit these qualities all of the time. That's why this is, in some ways, an archetype. In some ways, we valorize and make this person, anyone who appears to be doing these things, is considered quite heroic, and we tell jokes about this all the time. This is some academic work about the ideal worker and what it means for how we conceptualize work and what kind of person is valued in what ways in the workplace. We get that deeper. This is a Facebook post that made me laugh. So it's a crossing out of good things come to those who wait and see. Yeah, no. Good things come to those who work their asses off and never give up. Now, what's funnier to me about this Facebook post is not just that it was on Facebook, but who posted it on Facebook. And I'm going to tell you about that first in a second. Okay, so the two questions that I want us to think about in the next, I don't know, 20 minutes, 25 minutes before we go off and have a drink, is how do people, and as in people, I mean you and me and Jillian, live in terms of the myth of the ideal worker? Because we all live in terms of it. Doesn't necessarily mean you enact it. It doesn't necessarily mean you're doing all those things that I suggested. But you cannot work in today's economy and not be aware of this myth and be living in terms of it in some way or another. And then the second equally important question is, what is the role of information technologies in our everyday life? And how do these technologies figure in to what it is to enact this myth? And how do they help us do it all, or potentially not? And so I'm gonna, as I said, I'm gonna base this talk on actual research. So I'm in the final stages with a close colleague of finishing a book manuscript, of what, which this is one slice. And the book manuscript is based on quite a big research study we did. So we went into a hotel management firm. Why hotel management? Because they let us in. And we spent about 5 months getting to know these people and learning about technology in the workplace. We conducted 91 interviews, talked to 75 different employees and a bunch of their spouses. We just shadowed individuals, went to meetings, et cetera. Then, shadow means you walk around with them. It's basically it. They let you sit in on meetings. They talk you through their day. This is kind of classic qualitative ethnographic techniques, of which many of you will learn in my class coming up. Then we did the kind of crazy move of emailing a bunch of these people and saying, hey, what do you think of us coming home with you? You think that's a little crazy, but by then they knew us. We'd oftentimes spoken to their spouse, and the vast majority said, sure. So we then did a study of life outside the workplace. The goal of this was to understand something like work-life balance. I put that in quotes. I hate doing that when we talk, but you can't say work-life balance without scare quotes. To understand what that means from the, quote, life perspective, as if work isn't life. But you know what I mean, outside of the workplace. And the only way that's only ever been studied through survey design, through surveys or interviews that happen in the workplace. So we wanted to actually go home with people and see what their lives were like outside of work. Now, this has become a much bigger study because when you go home with people, you know what you see? You see them as parents. You see them as complex people. You see them as people trying to stay in shape, trying to get enough sleep. You see them as people who go to church and have friends and lives and all kinds of things they value. So our book is much broader than work-life balance. But we went home with these people. Each family we observed for about 60 to 80 hours. It was 14 initial visits, and then we followed up 3 to 4 times the next couple of years. We went to church, we went to amusement parks, we went shopping, swim meets, many, many sporting children events. I put on a baby shower with someone. We just kind of were there. And so we've kept up engaging with people for several years. So I'm going to tell you a couple stories. And all of these stories are accurate in the sense that they were, well, you'll see one of them was not actually observed, but the other two were observed and are about these people. So first I'm gonna tell you about Tim. Tim is a senior VP of operations. He's also a single father of three. Okay, I'm just gonna tell you a story about Tim. So after a busy weekend, Tim Andrews Tuesday morning has gotten a little out of hand. Tim has taken the day off of work to get his three girls ready for a 4th of July trip with his ex-wife, Tanya. He moves with efficient speed to pack their lunches, and he's supposed to take them to Tommy's house after meeting a painter that he has hired to redo the living room. So the painter's scheduled to come at 8. It's past 8, no painter. The clock is approaching 8:30. He's getting the lunches packed, and things are starting to get hectic because the night before, Noah, who happens to be Tim's CEO, sent out a meeting request about 9 p.m. for an 8:30 a.m. conference call. And Tim accepted the call. He's not really thinking. So he accepted the call despite a lack of warning, despite the inconvenient time, and despite the fact that he'd actually taken the day off, right? So of course the painter shows up just before the call is slated to begin. And now all of a sudden Tim finds himself distracted as he tries to prepare for the call, show the painter around, and get his girls packed and out the door. The call begins, the painter needs his input, and suddenly his daughter, Olive, begins to pepper him with questions about what's in their lunches. He ignores his daughter for a second. So what does his daughter do? She texts mom and says, "We have no lunches." The ex-wife. So he's still on the conference call, attempting to focus on what his colleagues and the CEO is saying, and he starts getting concerned texts from his ex-wife saying, "The girls have no lunches, what's wrong with you?" And the painter's asking questions. You can see it, right? The call ends, Tim mollifies his ex-wife through text, and he assures the girls that he actually has packed the lunches and everything is ready. Later, he wryly admits, "All three of these things collided at the exact same time, and I didn't really do any of them well. It was just a horrible clash. I made some assumptions. I wasn't my best. I wasn't my best dad. I wasn't my best employee. I don't even know why I said yes to that call, and I wasn't my best customer for the painter." Okay. It happens. I'll tell you another story. This is Teresa. She works in accounting. She's in charge of payroll. And she's the one who has to cut the paychecks. People want their paychecks. They care about this, right? But it happens to be that the day that paychecks are due is also a day that it's her turn to take her son to a biweekly kind of health visit, the local hospital that her husband and she switch off on. So she's stationed in the basement waiting room of the local hospital, sitting in a green plastic chair. She connects her phone to the hospital Wi-Fi. Then she plugs her laptop into her smartphone and tethers to the internet from her phone and attempts to access the internal network of the company. And she starts printing checks. So she gets a call from her controller, Eleanor, who says with a friendly but pointed voice, "So I'm just wondering if you did the checks. It's 3 p.m. So Teresa is able to say definitively, and she's got a pretty infectious smile, with an infectious smile, "Oh yes, I'm working on it right now." She congratulates herself for being one step ahead. However, she can't maintain the Wi-Fi connection. After 5 checks, she gets totally frustrated. She logs off, she checks Facebook on her phone, and she posts the "work your asses off" thing. I don't know if she did it that day, but she's the one who posted it. And she goes home and gets to work, right? So she actually starts her work at 5 p.m. She gives her son a Nintendo DS, and they sit on the couch for a couple hours till her husband comes home around 7. He stopped for groceries on the way home. She continues to work as he puts groceries away, makes some dinner for their son. He gets the son to bed. She continues to work, check Facebook. She's moving through Facebook, running labor reports on their internal system and answering work emails. And she goes to bed around midnight. She hasn't taken her computer off her lap all night. That's really standard for her. Okay, this is my last story. This is Nancy. She's the regional director of sales and a single mother of 2. This one I didn't observe. She rolls over and it's 2 a.m. This I can tell you, Zachary, because I have seen her bedroom. The blue throw pillars that decorate her king bed are stacked neatly on a side chair, and she's got a puffy blanket pushed down at her feet. There's a dull glow from the nightlight in the hall that shines into her room. She's a restless sleeper, and she's sensitive to unusual sounds. So she wakes up, she pauses for a second to make sure no one, either of her children, are stirring in their bedroom. Everything's quiet. In Instinctively, Nancy pushes her hair out of her face and grabs her smartphone from the nightstand, and she checks her email. Nothing. She rolls over and attempts to go back to sleep. Nancy wakes at least once every night, she says. As a regional manager overseeing multiple properties, she communicates frequently with many managers, and almost every night, she finds herself half awake, reaching for her phone. Asked why, she pauses and laughs. She's pretty awkwardly. I don't know. I just check to see if anything has come in. I mean, because, well, sometimes I work at night, and if I send emails asking questions to people, I guess I'm looking for responses. But I don't know if it's that. I mean, maybe I'm just curious. I mean, it's not like I'm going to make it any better or worse at 2 a.m. I don't ever really respond, but I will always check. I see some heads nodding. Is this other people's life? Okay, whether or not you check, how many of you have a smartphone within arm's reach of your pillow every night? Thank you very much. Okay. So, I want to ask you for a second, what's going on in these stories, for real? What do you get from these stories? They're all real. They're not crazy people. They're not even living particularly intense lives.
Context.
Tell me more.
You're putting a face on a lot of the stories and you're allowing them to draw your solutions.
Yeah, well, yes. These are real people. They're definitely real people. But you say drive your solutions. The question is, what's the problem? Is there a problem? Is it conflict?
Well, if you say that I'm not being a great father, I'm not being a great customer, and I'm not being a great worker all at the same time, everything is suffering and not taking advantage of that ability to always be connected.
Yeah, Tim's story is particularly good for that. So there is some experienced conflict. Now, I have to say that I picked three stories out of innumerable stories, and many of them people do not actually feel conflict. In that moment, Tim did, and he articulated it. But oftentimes, we don't really feel it. We feel like we're doing it all. And in many times, we are able to do it all. But I'm going to talk to you about what doing it all has come to mean. So are these people good at their jobs? I can tell you that these three, because I know them, these three individuals are all incredibly good at their jobs. At least they are incredibly valued by their colleagues and their bosses. They are thought to be doing incredibly good. What does it mean to be qualitatively good at your job? It's something that's very hard to define. I have people ask me all the time, well, how can you measure, you know, what's the change in productivity with technology? I said, well, you just tell me how to measure productivity and I'll tell you the answer. You know, it's incredibly hard to assess things like whether or not you're actually good at your job. These people are valued and they're considered good at their jobs. Are their lives sustainable? They would tell you they absolutely are. Are their lives going to change? One of the fascinating things we discovered is that almost everybody we talked to at any one point in time told us everything was going to get better soon. My favorite is Nancy. I was with Nancy for 3 years, and every single time I visited Nancy, it was the busiest time she'd ever experienced, and every single time it was going to get better. I'm like, yes, Nancy, I believe you. Yes, their lives are not going to get better soon. These are their lives. What, you know, the stories they tell themselves about that is a different thing. And then I want to ask you something else. You brought up family. Tim is a good one that brings together. But what, there are two other very powerful myths that I'm just going to just put out here, and then we're going to move on, that both compete with and intensify the myth of the ideal worker. How many of you want to be a perfect parent? So we have an equally strong myth in Western society right now about the kind of perfect parent and the cult of intensive parenting. This is someone who is able to engage in quality time with their children, who provides innumerable enrichment activities that are to get to them into college and get them a job and make them well-rounded humans and somehow happy. We monitor them. We monitor their homework. We monitor their screen time. We monitor where they are at any one point. And if we don't monitor them, if they go to the
And just like the worker myth, we prioritize our family above all else. The perfect parent is. Not all of us, but the perfect parents. We're also supposed to be fit. We're supposed to eat right. We're supposed to make organic green juice every morning. I had one family who did that. It was fascinating to watch how much labor went into their green juice. And how good they, and they were so proud of themselves. We are supposed to have me time. But you know what we're supposed to do in the me time? Are you supposed to watch The Bachelor and drink a glass of wine? Not what you actually do, but what are you supposed to do? No, you're supposed to work out. How many people I talked to that said, oh, I got my me time in today, and that meant going to the gym. Good for them. I mean, there's nothing wrong with using that time, but like this is what is virtuous me time. People who did watch The Bachelor and drink a glass of wine, which many, many people do, I have no idea how popular The Bachelor can be, they do that with an air of shame, right? A little bit like a big old rebellion to the world, like, you know, some fingers and I'm gonna watch The Bachelor and drink my wine. One thing that is interesting as a side note, what is not part of the kind of cultivated body myth is sleep. We generally valorize what we call the sleepless elite, which I guess are about 1.5% of the population of people who actually do thrive on 4 hours or less of sleep. But we valorize that as, and those of us who need more than that amount of sleep, you know, we're not going to brag about it. Okay, so imagine that you're trying to be that worker, as well as think about how are you going to engage your needs at the same time, these myths at the same time. So is it possible to do all this? It's absolutely 100% not. And unless you think that I'm being overly gendered here, we've got to put this guy out. It is absolutely not. It is actually impossible to be any one of these myths to its full extent, where you're prioritizing that role and that kind of, you know, social world above all others. No less is it impossible to manage all three of them. Okay. So is your smartphone helping you? Is it going to save you? I went back in time and pulled out some ads. A student of mine a few years ago did a wonderful analysis of advertising of mobile devices starting in the decade of 2000 to 2010. This ad is from 2002. You knew you'd rule the world someday. All it took was this. Look at her. She's ruling the world. This is from 2005. I called the office after I sent the emails, and I shrieked as we ran to the end of the pier in a mad rush to do nothing at all. I don't know how she's talking on the phone running down the pier, but that's okay. And lastly, this is also for 2005. I checked my email after I finished the conference call. I replied to all, and I adjusted my sunglasses, took aim at the asphalt, popped the clutch, ignoring the view in my rear view mirror. Is this your experience? This one's not quite so ridiculous, but it's still this kind of, you've got this person who's like somehow being the perfect parent while keeping up with email and smiling. And get the smartphone that does it all so you can too. Whether or not we laugh at these now, they seem a little anachronistic from the perspective of 2018. This is what we've been sold for how long? And at some level, they're not entirely wrong. So I ask you to think about, what is your relationship with your smartphone? Does it allow you to do more? Absolutely. You can communicate at the last minute. You can coordinate at the last minute. You can make sure that if something happens with your children, you can get the nanny there, or blah, blah, blah. You can use diet apps. You can track your steps. You can order a healthy meal to your house. I just had something show up at my house yesterday when it was like $50 off. You can order keto meals or vegan meals or every other sign. I mean, it just takes enough money and a smartphone, right? And you can actually work better, parent better, and take care of your body better, right? that throughout of this, every single one of these ads is a single human being and the word I. I. And you know what this does? Well, that's you, but she's still by herself there. You know what these words do? They frame this as an individualistic problem. That if you don't have enough time, that's your fault. You didn't manage your time well, you're not being effective. That you have a relationship with your smartphone, and it may be one of individual prowess, and it may be one of addiction. But even if it's addiction, that's your damn fault. That's a personal and individual pathology, right? Nowhere in this myth of the ideal worker, or in this way that we've incorporated technology into our sense of everyday life, is a true recognition of the collective and structural dynamics that are at play. These are tools that tie us to other people, as well as news and sporting events and whatever else it is. They are things that tie us to the outside world, but yet we continue to frame them as individualistic experiences. I can't let him do this because I really hate this picture with all my heart, but it fits so perfectly. They did this like stupid story on me when I first got to UCI, and somebody in the communications department decided that they should put me with all these disembodied smartphone arms. I couldn't actually find the picture I wanted, which was that one of our professors at the time did a little photo contest to see who could manipulate this photo to the funniest effect. And one of mine was like, it shows, like they've switched all the arms, so it looks like I have this like, you know, peacock feather of arms behind me. But I couldn't find that one. So what I want to talk about here is that in some ways, our smartphones, I think, are this absolute, this is from the usability and design standpoint, this absolutely pernicious and brilliant tool. Because you know what they do? For those of you who think the next stage of connectivity is going to be wearable devices or implants or the whole like it's going to be under my skin and I can see things or even watches, I don't buy it. You know why? The smartphone continues to perpetuate the illusion and the visceral sense that you're in control. You can put it down. You can believe that others are using it in their own time or in their dead time. But yet you can put it in your pocket. So it's not like even a light laptop or an iPad. You feel the buzz. How many of you ever felt the phantom buzz? So it's simultaneously completely intimate and part of our bodies, and yet we know rationally that we can put it away. That allows us to perpetuate the sense that we are in control and that this is an individual relationship with the device rather than a structure and social dynamic. And I think it's really interesting to think about, and the idea, you know how people say, so a lot of times you see this stuff on popular media, what do we do about this smartphone addiction problem? What do they tell you? Put it down. Disconnect. Take your technological Sabbath, whatever it is. And I say that's real nice. Because we don't live in a world of free smartphones. No one person can choose to put it down. If you do, it actually has consequences, oftentimes professionally. It has consequences personally. Because as I was telling cohort 3 the other day, what happens if I don't respond to my best friend's text? They worry. They think I don't care. It's a lack of respect. If I don't respond to my boss's text, I'm not dedicated, I'm not competent, and I don't respect them. So, although we can do things to try and change the dynamic and say, oh, we shouldn't be connected all the time, we actually can't return to a world where it is completely reasonable to say, I didn't get your message. I actually remember when my family got an answering machine, right? Like, that was a big deal. That you could get home at the end of the day and get a message that someone left for you. Before that, there was no answer. So it was completely possible to say I didn't get your message, and that's just gone. I mean, it's we've taken this for granted with each other. So what I want to leave you with is the sense that this is not an individual problem, that this is a social problem, and it really is only going to have collective solutions if we think a solution is in order. So I'm not actually trying to say that maybe I'm using the word problem too loosely. This is our way of being. I think we need to articulate that to ourselves and each other and then decide if it's a problem and then what we are going to do about it. So this is what we call the spiral of expectations. And what I think is interesting here is that, yes, while your tool allows you to do more, guess what? What it is to be an ideal worker actually intensifies. In the era of answering machines, you were not expected to be available 24/7. You could be the most kick-ass employee on the block and not get any messages from the time you left work until the next day. So what it actually means to inhabit these roles and be these people has changed, like, substantially. I did early research in the 2002-2003 with venture capitalists and lawyers when they first got BlackBerries. They thought they were so cool, right? And I walked away from about 60 interviews with these people, and I was a little bit disheartened because every single one of them told me they loved their device and that it allowed them to be them better. I already want to be on top of things. This just allows me to be me more effectively. So they were very much thinking of it as like, this is who I am, this is what I do, this is what it takes to be successful in my job, and this thing allows me to do it more. What they were not noticing, which I was able to kind of tease out of these interviews, were how they had collectively shifted their expectations of what it was to be good at their job. Right, so they would say things like, oh, no one expects me to get back to them right away. I just do my emails in my dead time. It allows me to keep up with things. Remember, this was 2002. We're all very, like, bright-eyed and bushy-tailed about these devices. And then I'd say, oh, okay. And then later in the interview, I'd say, so now, like, when you send an email to someone, how quickly do you expect them to get back to you? And they'd go, 7 or 8 minutes. Right? So they'd frame this as something that was completely under their control, but yet they were collectively shifting what it meant to be good at their job. So if you think about this, if you think about this as a spiral of expectations, then the tool allows us to change our idea of what it is to be these kind of orienting myths that we live in terms of. So at the individual level, you start using your device. Well, first at the collective level, they exist. And they exist in large numbers. If you've just got a first mover advantage, then you might actually feel like you're in control. So I talked to the senior VP of this hotel management firm when they were going to be made public. And they decided, whatever year it was, way past the origin of smartphones, they decided, I think it was like 2010, that they were going to be the 24/7 hotel management firm. No one else was in their industry at the time. That was going to be their strategic advantage. And it probably was for what? A year? Until everybody else said they were going to be the 24/7 hotel management firm. And then you lose that. Okay. So first you've got a prevalence of mobile devices, then you have individuals using them. Because it's great, helps me do more, be more, be on top of stuff. Then, guess what? You start inferring that everyone's on. For better or worse, no assumptions yet what that means, but I just know everyone around me has one. Every single one of you has one. I know it. Every one of you, single one of you has one probably within handheld distance right now. Okay. Each one of you starts using it, and guess what? You feel an increased sense of agency and control here. Doing more, I'm on top of stuff, I'm not worried about things blowing up in the office while I'm sitting here in this room all day, whatever it is. Then, this is where it gets tricky. We begin collectively shifting our assumptions of what devices make reasonable or possible. It is now considered reasonable to send someone an email at 10 p.m. and ask for work to be done by the next morning. Completely reasonable in most workplaces. Is that true for you guys? Yeah. Then you've got intensifying patterns of use. Then you've got ways of using the device now begin to signal things that they didn't use to signal. So this is how we signal dedication. This is how we signal competency. This is how we signal care. So this week comes when I didn't get the message at 10 p.m. and do the forecasting report. All of a sudden, I'm not good at my job, right? Then, this is at the individual level again, when you use the device to prove dedication and care, this begins to overwhelm your individual sense of agency and control. So now no longer are you in control of it, but it feels like it's in control of you. And then we have the shifting or evolving understanding of what it takes to enact these key myths. And we've got these internalized expectations that this is who I am and this is what I have to do. I love that. What's important about the stories I told you earlier is that these people don't feel like their lives are crazy. They don't feel like they're not good parents. They don't feel like this is anything out of the ordinary at all. It's only when you take their stories and snippets and tell them out of context in a way that it begins to feel a little crazy. And that's what I'm going to leave you with. So I say thanks to Christine Beckman. She's my co-author in the book, and we've done all the research and writing together. And Ellie Harmon. Harmon was an excellent graduate student at UCI who also collected the data with us. So thank you all very much.
If you count dead time?
The term, dead time.
Oh, I know. Isn't that crazy? The idea that you're dead when you're not working? So much of the language and language patterns and the metaphors are embedded in how we think about this. I actually have a whole
owned by the individual, managed by the individual, and sold by the individual in this kind of classic transactional capitalist exchange of time, use, labor. But really, we live in this increasingly connected world in which social context takes more and more importance with the increase of ambiguous jobs. So when we work in service jobs, in professional service firms, in knowledge work, all of these things actually erode the classic time, you know, like you're gonna work for an hour in the factory and then log out. The idea that you're selling your time labor for money, that contract is eroded, but we haven't actually established new theories or language about time to keep up with the changes in the work, to nature of work.
Can you think of apps that incentivize users to stay off their devices, like points or anything?
I think anything is only gonna work if it's actually deeply embedded in the culture and norms of the immediate environment. So it doesn't have to be that you change the world, but you have to believe that if you rack up those points, there's not gonna be any formal or informal ways that you're gonna get censored for that. You actually have to believe that your company and your colleagues and your immediate boss is on board, right? Because so I've worked in organizational change efforts, and you know, the company can say whatever the hell they want. If your immediate boss, if you don't trust that they're gonna actually not give you a poor review for racking up points, that's fine. But yes, I do believe there are micro collectives where this can change.
All right, so now we're gonna take advantage of those, some of that downtime and fun time and networking time. There, I am told there is much alcohol and much food. In this building right here next door to us, up on the sixth floor, it's also a beautiful patio. It looks like it's gonna be a gorgeous late afternoon and evening if you wanna check out the view of the campus and so on. But the folks that you just saw give presentations will have their posters and demos in some cases, as well as detailed books. If
like
you wanna,
me, I'm like, I don't have a poster.
She will not be doing a demo. But we do really encourage you to come, socialize, hang out, check out demos, do things like that. Sixth floor of this building right here. So you will have to go outdoors for a moment.